We're working on something in Next.js I want to show you an early look at, and it's called partial pre-rendering. It allows you to have the best parts of both static and dynamic rendering in the same page with
no new APIs.
Let's take a look. If we go to partialprerendering.com, if I reload the page, you'll notice it's really fast. And that's because we have fast global ISR, so we have a fast initial static shell, and then the dynamic part is streamed in after the fact. So the recommended products, the information about when you can get this product, the customer reviews, all highlighted by this pink dot. And the best part is this is all programmatically defined how you want. So you get to control what the user experience is like. So in one request to the browser, you're able to immediately get back that fast static shell, and then basically concatenate on the dynamic parts or stream in the dynamic parts after the fact without having to do any additional work. So let's look at this demo and see how we're able to do this with no new APIs defined by your suspense boundaries. So I have the code running on the left in my editor. On the right, I'm just looking at a blank page right now. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to navigate to localhost 3000. And we're going to see the browser loading spinner spin and spin for a couple seconds. We're waiting for the slowest data fetch on the page to finish before we render all of the content. So it's kind of all or nothing. And I have these times defined by some constants in my application. So the reviews, for example, take 2 seconds. Now, the great thing about partial pre-rendering is that I have the flexibility of how I want to define this loading experience in my application. So for example, let's say that these reviews, the slowest part of our application, maybe instead of directly fetching these here with some delay, maybe we want to wrap these in suspense and we want to have a fallback for the loading skeleton to show. So let's take a look going back to our blank page and then navigating to localhost 3000. It's a little bit faster. So we aren't waiting for that slowest data fetch in the tree now, which is the 2 second delay. And if I reload the page, it's even, you know, it's pretty decent. It's a little bit better. But what if we could go even further? There's other places in our application where we had some asynchronous components that were fetching data, like in this header, where we're fetching the cart count from the cookies. You know what? Let's put a suspense boundary on that. And then also over for looking at pricing, we also had the ability to add to your cart, which is reading from cookies. So we should put a suspense boundary around that. And then also some of these user-specific details as well, too. So I'm programmatically defining where I want the suspense boundaries using my code, defining fallbacks, and then the Next.js compiler can automatically create the static optimization here based on your code. So if I go back to about blank now with all these changes and I navigate forward to this new updated version, it's really fast. The first version that we get has the majority of the static shell because we've made as much of this page static as possible. And then subsequent reloads, as you can see by the pink pulsating dots, those are the parts that are streamed in after the fact. Now, to go a little bit more in depth on this, I'm going to walk through the blog post that Sebastian and Malta wrote, which is fantastic. So we'll step through here and I'll just provide some commentary on some of the bits inside of here. So we released this at Next.js Conf with Next.js 14. It's experimental, definitely experimental, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. PPR combines ultra quick static edge delivery with fully dynamic capabilities. You can try it out, okay? So let's talk about some of the trade-offs eliminated. I'll just pull this up bigger so we can look at it. So there's been different ways of rendering on the web. Each have different trade-offs. You have kind of the traditional Jamstack approach where you're doing client-side data fetching. It's great because you get to see that fast edge delivery, that fast initial static shell, but you're doing a lot of fetching on the client, which means more client-side JavaScript and more waterfalls. So not as great. Traditional SSR had a lot of things right. It was actually a pretty simple programming model as well, too. So you didn't have to have extra round trips for your dynamic content. Your compute or your server was close to your database. And it was pretty easy to do. The problem that I just showed with that demo is when you did have slow data fetches, it would block kind of this all or nothing rendering until the slowest data fetch was done. So we can do a little bit better than that. You might have seen some folks, some frameworks, Eben Brussel talk a little bit about Edge SSR, and we've kind of realized there's some other trade-offs with this as well, too. While you do get that fast delivery, you still have to run compute. So there's no getting away from the startup time of your compute. And also, you now have introduced waterfalls between your edge location and your database. So you want your compute to be close to wherever your data is at. The great thing about PPR that we believe with partial pre-rendering is that you can eliminate a lot of these trade-offs by taking advantage of the great parts about static while still being able to stream in dynamic content. One battle-tested programming model. So this is probably one of the coolest parts to me, is that the static optimization happens when you flip on the feature flag for now. By default, you don't need to do anything else. And then you get it defined in your code where you access the dynamic bits, like headers or cookies, when you want to opt into dynamic rendering. So you really get a slice and dice your component tree to make as much static as possible as you would want. Now, you might be thinking, okay, we've done this before. It's true. There have been parts of this that have happened before, but we think that this is a better way of mixing the static and dynamic contents together in kind of one cohesive world. And it's great because for a lot of folks in the Next.js ecosystem, they've been using Suspense for a bit now. So it feels very familiar and there's no new APIs. So if you have an e-commerce page like this, you're going to get that static shell that I just showed. And then the parts that are inside of the dynamic holes will run dynamically and stream in the content. Okay, under the hood of PPR. So we pre-render a static shell. When a user visits the page, that fast shell is served, allows them to consume the page. And then the work happens in parallel. This is huge, actually, because basically while your visitor, while your customer is looking at this fast initial shell, we're in parallel kicking off a bunch of the other expensive work. So parsing scripts, loading style sheets, loading fonts, the static markup, all of that stuff can take advantage of all the work that the React architecture gives us. There's a great blog post here if you want to dive into this a little bit more. So you can kind of think about it like the good parts of ISR with the good parts of SSR as well, too. It's not something necessarily brand new. It's combining the best parts of the existing models. And it's really not just for doing a shell. Depending on what you're trying to build, this diagram is trying to highlight that you can pretty much decide exactly how much of your page you want to pre-render when you write it through your code defined through Suspense boundaries. So maybe you want to have basically the majority of your page statically pre-rendered using the ISR model. So you can still update that content using the existing caching and revalidating system that's built in to Next.js. So that's pretty powerful. You really get the control. It's open to all frameworks. So while we're initially releasing this in Next.js, the great part about this is that it's building on existing infrastructure that we've built at Brussel, and we have a standard kind of API for frameworks to build into. So, Astro and Nuxt and SvelteKit and Remix, they all use the same build output API or this framework API that Next.js uses as well. So it's available on Canary. You can flip it in a feature flag, but this is the big part. It's not yet recommended for production use, so please proceed with caution. There's still some things that don't work. Probably wouldn't ship this to prod today, but we wanted to at least talk about some of the new things that are happening here and kind of give you a heads up. I also want to show one last example, which is my own blog, and talk about how partial pre-rendering is hopefully going to make this a lot easier for me. So on a blog post, the majority of this page is static. And in the top right, I have the view count. Now, the way that I've been able to make this page entirely static and use ISR, so similar to the pages router model where you would define a revalidation time for the page, is inside of the page, so inside of this dynamic route here, I have a suspense boundary that's wrapping the views component. This views component is an async component that goes to my database, it fetches the views back, and then it renders this view counter. Now, this works, but unless over here on the right, unless I use this unstable cache function, this whole page would run dynamically. So not just this component, but this entire page would run dynamically. And like I said, there's just that one component in the top right. That's the only thing that requires me to run compute. So this works, but I want to make it easier and be able to have fresh data on every single request. I don't even need to use the stale while revalidate pattern here. So I just flipped over to a new branch where I've been experimenting with partial pre-rendering. And you'll notice not a lot really changes. So on the right, rather than wrapping this function with a cache and defining the revalidation time that I want, I can just go directly to the database. And then on the right, again, I'd already set up a suspense boundary, so I was already prepared for this change. I flipped on the feature flag. And then the only difference here is that I'm using NoStore to opt in Next.js into dynamic rendering. Now, there's a bunch of different ways that you can opt into dynamic rendering. If you're using cookies, if you're reading headers, if you're setting NoStore on a fetch directly. Since I'm going directly to the database using an ORM, I can just use this NoStore function directly. And that's really all it takes. Now, the rest of this page is able to be partially pre-rendered. The static shell is able to be created. And then just the views are able to be streamed in when you hit the page. So that's all it takes. All right, so that was a fast run through of all things partial pre-rendering. Again, this is experimental. You can upgrade to Canary, flip on the feature flag and try it out, but probably don't put this in production just yet. But we at least wanted to show you what we're working on and get you excited about the future direction of where we're headed. If you have any questions or feedback, or you try this out and something doesn't work, just let me know. You can leave a comment down below or open an issue on GitHub. Peace.